let us all get into meditation. Sit comfortably, hands into hands, fingers into fingers. Gently close your eyes. I will play the music. Just observe your breath, normal, natural, easy, soft, tender breath, my dear friends. Relax. Let us all deeply settle down wherever we are. Let us all keep our thoughts outside of our room and we can address them later. Choose comfortable posture for yourself. Do not need to sit straight. Sit as comfortable as possible. Hands into hands, fingers into fingers. Gently close your eyes. Let us all sit in meditation, just like sun is setting in the west. Today, give an intention to connect with yourself deeply. Take a deep breath and relax, my dear friends. Relax your face. Your forehead, eyebrows, eyes, cheeks, chin, jaw, and tongue. Relax. Relax your neck. Relax. relax your shoulders. Wherever your focus goes, the energy flows there. Relax your shoulders. Relax your hands. Relax your chest. Relax your stomach. Relax your back, upper back and lower back. Relax your legs, thighs, knees, lower legs, feet and toes. Relax. Now let us all get into deep meditation by observing our simple, normal, natural breath. You can pick a point on top of your nose or between your eyes area to observe the airflow going in and coming out. Thoughts will come and go. Whenever we are in thoughts, gently bring your attention back to your breath. That simple and soft breath, my dear friends. Be with your breath. Observe your inflow and outflow. Of your breath, my dear friends. Become one with your breath. Be with your breath. When you become one with your breath, your mind becomes empty. When the mind is empty, abundance of cosmic energy flows into your body through your Brahmarandhra. The energies of cosmos healing energies, love energies, compassion energies, abundance energies, let them flow inside your body, inside your Nadi Mandala. when the energies flows into your Nadi Mandala, our mind and body gets healed. When we accumulate a lot of cosmic energy inside our body, our third eye gets activated with that energy. Our chakra system gets balanced with that energy. Be with your breath, my dear friends. Great process happens when we are with our breath. Observe your breath. Normally, naturally breath. Be with your breath. Go deeper and deeper into yourself with the help of your breath.
Thank you.
Be with your breath. Last 3 minutes. Feel the greater energies inside you and are around you. Feel the deepness of your being. Last 1 minute. Be with your breath. last 30 seconds. Last 10 seconds. Relax and come back to your body. And whenever you are ready, place your hands on your eyes for 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Slowly, you can open your eyes and take your own time to settle down, to sink in. Friends, hope you all had wonderful meditation today. Very deep energies. And I'm so grateful to this meditation. Because of this meditation, because of this practice, I was able to increase my energies. I was able to elevate my energies. And with that help of energies, I am able to connect with many great grandmasters, great masters all over the world, from all over the places, like you. And meditating together is always, always, always blessed feeling for me. Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity. So friends, in my journey, reading books are very, very important. So as we are reading, we understand what is life more, right? What we know is very less. We understand life more. We understand from somebody's perspective. We understand from somebody's learning. So there is so much to learn. What we know is very, very, very little. I will say that there is so much to learn. There is so much to learn. This learning is never-ending journey, my dear friends. So today, I take this great opportunity to share about great, great, great grandmaster Milarepa. So Milarepa is a grandmaster. He's from Tibet. He was the master of 11th century. He was born on 1040. Now we are in 2021. Imagine, still it's more than 10 centuries, but still we remember this great master's name, this great master's history, this great master's practices, his achievements, his accomplishments. We are still enjoying his fruits. We are still enjoying the messages of great master Milarepa. So I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful for this master, because after I read this book called Milarepa, I understood what a student must have the qualities, right? So let me start with the story of Milarepa, my dear friends. So Milarepa was born in a very great, very settled family, farmer's family. So his father owns a good amount of land. He's a landowner. And they would do agriculture and they make good amount of money and living very, very happy, very joyful life, Milarepa. And no responsibility at the young age, because very well treated, very, very well in family, very well with wealth and all, right? So he was completely enjoying his life to the fullest.
So all of a sudden, what happens is his father passed away when he was very, very young, like at the age of 8 or 9 years old. And then after his father passed away, they were living in combined family. Immediately, his father's brother and his wife started treating them like a piece of trash. They were treating them like his servants. So they took all the valuable things from them. They took all the land. They took everything. So they are just working as a servants in their own home. So his mother is working as a servant at home, cooking, cleaning, taking care of animal, taking care of everything. Like, you know, so much tired. And him, like he was doing all the things like in the fields, right? You know, agriculture is in the fields. He was working and they put their little sister into the work as well. So his mother was so sad from the heart. She could not take because she was living a very happy, very loving, very joyful life with her husband and kids and very good family, right? All of a sudden, the moment of this situation changed, they started treating not so well, and she could not take. She could not take her children working in the field. She could not take the troubles what they are giving to these people. So she decided, okay, you know, let me take a revenge on them. So I have to take a revenge on this, her husband's brother and sister-in-law. So what she does is she sends Milarepa to a teacher where they teach us black magic. So she told Milarepa, you know, you just go and learn all the black magic skills and we are going to take the revenge. And he was also very sad because he sees his mother suffering, crying and sleeping on the floor and eating very less food and every 24 hours working, right? So his son also had that kind of grudge towards these people. And then he goes to the master and he learns all the black magic within 2 or 3 years. So then after learning the black magic, he comes home and then he plays black magic. And because of that black magic, he kills his uncle, aunt and their kids. And the family becomes so miserable. And the village people thought, you know, these mother and this Milarepa and his sister are evil people. We cannot keep them in the town. We have to make them go away. So that's what they think. And finally, what they do is they just trap their mother in the cage. And his mother dies in that cage because they treat her like an evil woman because her son is evil. And they thought, you know, this lady is also evil and it's not good to keep the evil woman at the city. So she finally the village people, they kill Milarepa's mother too. And then only him and his sister left. So what happens is he carries even more anger on the village people. Before he was carrying angry on the only uncle and aunt. Now he's carrying the anger on village people too. So whatever black magic learned, right? So he wanted to create this hailstorm where he could put it on the fields so that, you know, they will lose their crop when the time comes. So he went to the another master to learn the skill. So finally he mastered there and he came here and then he was successful and he made that hail rain and hail rain came and all the crops was gone and, you know, all the villages were like very in very troubled situation. They were like, you know, dying from the hunger and they were crying. They could not take care of their families and lot of misery happened because of that situation. And then finally, he thought, you know, he would get satisfied after doing all these things. He was not feeling satisfied. And then one moment, he realized whatever he did was absolutely wrong. He felt so bad of killing his own uncle and aunt. He was feeling bad that, you know, because of that act, his mother is died and his sister is suffering. And because of that deed, you know, he given trouble to entire village people, like children, old people and whatnot, right? He felt so sad and so bad. Now I need to find some good teacher where I can come out of this miserable situation. He was feeling sad and he want to feel he want to get his life back normally, like. And then he just goes on searching master. He goes on searching master and then he finds a master. He says his story and he says that, you know, I am going to I just want to help myself to come out of this sorrow, this kind of grief inside me. I have a lot of guilt and a lot of grief. I want to come out of this situation. So that master says, yeah, why not? I can help you on that. So you stay with me. So while staying with that master, he was entire time Milarepa was sleeping. He was not doing anything. He was just sleeping. Then this guru recognized, okay, you know, if he's here, he's not going to learn anything. But he has that fire inside him to come out of that situation. So he says that, you know, there is a great master called Marpa. You go to him and then he's going to teach you further what you want to learn. And then he goes to village to find the master Marpa. So in one of the field, he meets a very tall guy. And he says, the moment he sees the tall guy, some kind of shivering, some kind of chills pass over to his body. And then he says, okay, should I ask this guy or not? He feels like a little hesitated to ask about Marpa. But he thought, you know, he need to find this master. So let me ask. So he goes and he asks, where can I find Master Marpa? Then he says, who are you? Then he tells his story and then he says that, you know, I am feeling very sad and I want to come out of this miserable life and I want to become that normal person, that like good person again. He explains him. So he says that, you know, I can find Marpa for you. Just meanwhile, you work in my field. That's what he says. So the Milarepa started working in his field, like, you know, with agriculture, right? You know, giving water and taking care of the plants, whatnot. He was doing it. So finally, he tells that Milarepa just to go and find that cave. In that cave, you will find Marpa Guru. And from there, you can learn your thing. So then he's all excited and then he says, okay, you know, let me go and meet this Marpa master. He goes and he went into the caves. The moment he went into the cave, he sees a person sitting in meditation posture. The person is none other than this tall guy only. So then immediately he comes and he bows his head on his feet and then he explains, okay, you know, please teach me. Something that, you know, I can come out of this situation. So his master says, are you very serious about knowing the truth? So he says, yes, I am very serious about knowing the truth and I will do whatever you say. Then his master says that, you know, go and start building a tower for me on top of the mountain, he says. So, you know, Tibetan, right? Lot of big rocks, big rocks and not too much help on top of the mountains. So his task is to build a tower for his guru. So he says that, okay, you know, maybe after building the tower, maybe my master will teach me the skills that I need to learn, the skills, the meditation technique, whatnot. And he just goes on top of the mountain. He spends many, many days to build the tower. So after, like, you know, quarter is done, then his master comes and checks the tower, and then half is done, almost 75 is done, and then his master comes and says that, okay, now I changed my mind, can you please build a tower which is square shape? And then, okay, you know, maybe my master changed my mind, okay, I want to keep my master happy. So what happens is, again he tore the building. So he will say that, you know, this is the space. You have to build it here only. It's not like, you know, next to the building you are constructing again, right? Now again, he demolished that building. And now again, he started building the square tower. So after square tower is done almost, and the master comes and says that, no, I changed my mind again. I want a tower which is crescent moon shape on top of the mountain so that people can see from the far. That's what he says. His hands, his legs were completely sore from constructing, lifting the heavy stones, whatnot, right? His body was completely became fragile because of this heavy load of labor work. But still he says, okay, you know, my master is saying, because he's going to, he is the one who is going to teach me meditation. I have to do this for him. So he starts building the crescent shaped tower almost. And then he comes and he says that, you know, I don't like this tower. You have to build something else. Then he gets very upset. He don't get mad about, he don't get mad at his teacher, but he gets very upset about his fate, his destiny. He knows that, you know, I have done lot of misery, things, miserable things in my life. And this is the reason why my master is doing this to me. This is the reason nobody is ready to teach me. That's what he gets. And he cries and he just runs away. And so one day, so the same day, master's wife, he asked, like, where is Milarepa? He did not come for lunch. And they were waiting for Milarepa and finally realized that, you know, he just ran away from the master. And Milarepa's wife asked, like, you know, why you are torturing so much? You could teach him, right? You know, show mercy. He's like, he's with you for many months and you are giving lot of heavy, heavy labor work to him. And then you are not showing any mercy whenever he comes and you are not even talking to him in a friendly manner. Whatever he does, you are just giving opposite answers and you are not at all kind to him. So then he feels very, very sad that, you know, I cannot lose my disciple, like my spiritual son. He says that I cannot lose my spiritual son. Oh God, send me this spiritual son back again. So then Milarepa, while he was going somewhere, because he knows that, you know, Marpa is not going to help me, so I have to go somewhere. And then he walks further and then he decides, okay, if Marpa is not teaching, I was there with Marpa for so long. If Marpa is not teaching, nobody is going to teach me. Okay, no matter what, I'm going to go back to my teacher Marpa, no matter what, whether he teaches or not, I'm going to stay there. And if he's not going to teach, I'm going to die there. That was his mindset. And he comes back to his master Marpa. And Marpa felt so happy to see this disciple back, Milarepa back. And then Milarepa was coming, he explains his wife and Milarepa that all the things what his master was doing is part of the process. Because this fellow has done a lot of bad karma in his life and it has to be burned in order to teach him meditation. So coming into the meditation is we have to burn a lot of karma. We have to burn all the bad karmas, bad deeds, whatnot, right? Then only one can enter into meditation. That's what he says. And doing all these things is part of burning his karma. When he's lifting the stones and breaking the stones and working hard, all the body is working, all the chakra is, like, you know, cleansing, all the nadi mandala is cleansing, everything was happening. Because Marpa knows, his guru, right? His Marpa knows what is happening inside, but his wife and Milarepa does not know, right? Even though he says they don't understand. So what gurus does is very mysterious and very, like, you know, they just do it. They don't feel like to explain anything to anyone, right? So they just do it. But he says to his wife and Milarepa that, you know, he knows he will be a great yogi in future. Because the day before Milarepa came, he had a dream. In his dream, he can see that, you know, he will be a upcoming great monk, great yogi for many generations. So that's what he sees. That's what Marpa sees. Not only Marpa, but many other masters, like where Marpa is connected with a group of another great Guru Mandala, right? So they also have the dreams. They also have the opinion on this Milarepa. But Milarepa came into a very different situation. So they don't reveal anything and everything, right? So they just want to test. They just want to test this master. They just want to clean this master's karma. So the part of the karma was cleansed with heavy building. Because whenever that's why, you know, Patri sir and GK sir and any masters, any like Isha Foundation masters or Prabhakar ji, any masters you take, they take disciples, they take students to trekking. So in trekking, a lot of great things happens. Last week, we discussed about trekking and nature, right? In trekking, we burn a lot of karma, my dear friends. we think only we are going for pleasure, but when we trek, when we do hard work, when we do anything with Mother Nature or anything, we are burning lot of karma. So that's why, you know, people who travels to this Himalayas travel, they feel so serene by end of their journey, because in that journey things are happening for them, things are changing, things are like, you know, getting cleansed. That's why the moment they reach there, they are already clean, and that's why they are able to feel that bliss and joy, and then connected with their godliness. So that's what he was doing. So finally, Marpa says that Milarepa, teaching meditation is not an easy process. So that's why we have to be very careful, because once we teach meditation, once you start practicing meditation, every person will acquire the siddhas. Siddhas means magic, right? So, you know, so when you have bad thoughts, magic is black magic. When you have right thoughts, magic is white magic. So the siddhas we increase in ourselves. So with that siddha, one can do good, one can do bad. So that's why they want to test the students, that whether the student is eligible to take this energies, the cosmic energy, which he is going to use it for himself to progress more in spirituality, or going to use for his own power and fame and name and whatnot, right? Those things. So masters always test. That's why people in back days, meditation teaching was a big secret because of this reason. So then finally he says that, you know, now you are ready, now let me teach you meditation. So he says that, you know, practice this meditation, and that's all that's what he says. And finally he says that, you know, you go to so and so cave and you practice there. So he goes to the cave. His master knows that, you know, this Milarepa is going to have lot of difficulties in his sadhana too. So his practice of meditation will go, but his master knows that, you know, he will not find food to eat. He will starve to death almost while doing sadhana. Master knows everything. Marpa knows everything. And before sending Milarepa to the caves, he tells that, you know, you will have this kind of trouble. But Milarepa makes a copper bowl. So in that copper bowl, his master puts little ghee, like butter, in the bowl. So he says that, you know, this will help you or protect you to keep your body in condition. That's what he says. So during his journey, he goes through lot of trouble, lot of hardships. He will not find food, caves, right? You know, going into the caves and cold, very cold in winter in Tibet, in Himalayas place. Imagine not having piece of cloth on his body. He's just sitting in the caves and meditating all days, all night. His only focus is only on meditation. And finally, after so much practice, he gets into that enlightenment state, and he realizes his purpose of life, and he sees what was the life before this life, and the incarnations, like many incarnations, who are all the masters are helping in this journey, how he is going to progress, and he can see the complete past, complete future at a time as a Sakshi Bhava, right? So he sees completely, and then he is very happy. And finally, he's also going to see that, you know, who is going to take this teachings of meditation further. So he sees in his vision that, you know, four of them are going to teach, three of them are going to be male, and one woman will spread the meditation to the future generation. He sees that. And Milarepa is not only meditation teacher or a student, but he's a great singer, poet. In Tibet, in his time, he was traveling from one place to other place to other place to other place, right? He always sings about his journey and about spiritualism and about the life. He just sings songs and poetry, and he keeps on moving. Everybody in the Tibet knows him as a sweet singer. Milarepa, Mila Milarepa means, the name means joyful to listen. His name itself is a joyful to listen. So he always sings, and you know, just like Kabir Das, you know, he created a great, great poetry, awakening poetries, right? What is life? What is real? What is unreal? All those things, right? Same Milarepa. He was singing and going and teaching meditation to one and all, one and all, one and all. So at the moment of death, so he lived for 83 years. So at the age of 83 years, he came to know that, you know, he's going to leave his body on this planet, Earth. Many, many great grandmasters from the heaven, all from the heaven, are, I cannot say heaven, but all the higher planes, from the higher planes, all the masters, like you name, they all came for his final breath ceremony. So like in that atmosphere, yogi, you know, he is a great yogi, great saint. Many people saw this vision that, you know, he is leaving the body. All the masters from all over the Tibet area, Himalaya area, came to visit Milarepa on his last day. And people witnessed, on like when he left his breath, people witnessed, you know, flower of shower like, you know, from the sky, all the masters are showering flowers on Milarepa, because his progress is so much in this lifetime, my dear friends. So why it is important is, in one lifetime, people take many lifetime after starting meditation also, people take many lifetimes to complete the goal, complete the things, complete the sadhana to become enlightened. But Milarepa's sadhana, Milarepa's hard work, Milarepa's serious commitment and serious sincerity made him enlightened in one single lifetime. So imagine, like, you know, a person who is like very cruel, very bad, very negative, black magic person to a great saint. Look at the difference. So in one lifetime, we think that, you know, it is not possible, this life. But in one lifetime, he achieved everything. That's why he's so special to many, many, many galactic masters, many astral masters, and many high plane masters. Milarepa is known to many masters. And one truth about Milarepa is, while doing sadhana, while doing meditation, we all know that, you know, Mount Kailash in Himalayas. So it is not as big as Everest, it is not as big as Machu Picchu, but still nobody could climb the mountain. We all know the stories, right? We all know the story. Many people go to Manas Sarovar. It is a journey. It is a travel. Like, you know, you landed there. From there, your journey is starting. You are traveling. You are going there. So he was doing the same thing. So everybody says that, you know, nobody except Milarepa climbed the Mount Kailash. Look at that. So look at how close... how vibrated this person to climb the Mount Kailash. Mount Kailash climbing is something so sincere and so serious, but Milarepa did it. So people in Tibet, they say that, you know, Milarepa climbed this Mount Kailash and he meditated there as well. So friends, Milarepa is a great, great master, and with his story, we can understand that, you know, with seriousness and sincere effort in our journey, in practicing meditation, we can achieve anything. We can achieve enlightenment, not only enlightenment. After enlightenment, there are many great stages, one after other. So he achieved many things, and he is a perfect example for all of us, saying that, you know, in one lifetime, if you are sincere, if you are serious, and you can become one. So I am very, very fortunate to speak about this master. Whenever I come across about Milarepa, always I get inspired. How much hard work, how much sadhana he did. And that fires me, and that helps me to create my sadhana more and to become more sincere and more serious about my sadhana. And I hope this story of Milarepa, story of this great grandmaster, helped you a lot, and take his life story as inspiration, and let us all continue moving in our spiritual journey, my dear friends. So I will stop here, and I will take if you have any questions or if you have any experience sharing about meditation or any connection with Milarepa.
Sheetal, what a beautiful session, great explanation, great wisdom sharing. What a great master. Thank you, thank you. Masters, please raise your hands if anyone has a question, either related to the story that we heard from Sheetal, or anything related to meditation, or anything related to spirituality. She's been doing meditation for such a long time, and she's been with so many grand masters, and she acquired a lot of a good wisdom that she can share. Okay, Nirmalaji.
Yes, namaste. Good morning, everyone. Hi, Sheetal. Excellent, really. In a very nice manner, you have told in a simple way. And very nice to know. And I think we should go in detail if you want to know much more about him or our previous karmas or how to improve ourselves, isn't it? So many times we feel, see, we are doing such sadhana, we are doing so much spiritual work, lot compared to others, and why we are having sufferings, why we are this. And this story will tell us why God gives us some lessons, you know, to learn something from the lessons. Really very inspiring in a very nice manner you told. As usual, very excellent way you have told. Thank you. Thank you so much, Sheetal. Nice to be here.
Thank you so much, madam. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashok sir.
Thank you, Nirmalaji.
Thank you, Sheetal ma'am, for the Milarepa story. So he has cleansed his bad karma by doing physical labor. Are there any ways to clear bad karma other than physical
labor? Yes, I mean, as we are practicing, as we are using our body for good work, we are definitely cleansing our karmas, and with service. With the service, we burn karma. And with meditation, definitely it is happening. So imagine, like, you know, we are all here on this journey, meditation. So we must have done many things in our life, knowing or unknowing, like, you know, in our past lives, right? We must have done that. We must have burned all the karmas. And that's why we were able to find this gift of meditation. From this story, Milarepa, just to getting that technique of meditation, he was going through so much. He was going through so much. Then with that story, I realized, okay, I must have burned all my karma. I am already cleansed being. Now it is meditation time. Now I don't think about karma. I have done bad karma. I am facing this. No, I will take it everything as a spiritual journey. I move forward because meditation is here with me right now. So just to focus on knowing ourselves, and that's all. It will take care of burning karma, master. Because yes, physically we burn karma. Meditation, we burn heavily. We karma, because in meditation, some people say that, you know, my back is hurting. So when somebody is saying back is hurting, they are burning karma while practicing meditation. So when you are feeling painful or inconvenient front body, you are burning karma of this current life. So that is the thing is happening. That is the process is happening. So if you go to master, they will explain very well. So yeah, there are many ways we are burning karmas, but we are in very, very good karma, sir. That's why we got this gift of meditation in our life.
Thank you.
Yeah, Shailaja ji, you are muted.
Hi. Ashok ji and Sheetal ji, very inspirational story. I'm so impressed. It was unbelievable, you know. the other day, actually, I was watching a Netflix documentary. This is about the little kids actually working in mines, and they were walking so many miles. I was almost in tears when I'm watching that testimonial, like why only some people, you know, are punished like this, you know. Those little kids didn't deserve it. So when I listened to your story, I was just, you know, thinking maybe, you know, this is probably karma, whatever, you know, that's why they were put through that path. You know, this is, that probably answers some of the questions I had, you know, by watching some of these documentaries like this. And also I just wanted to update on what I brought up yesterday. I said I was not able to meditate today. I came actually, I made my room dark. I had light before the other days, but today I made it pitch dark actually. And I just imagined, I don't know whether it was an imagination or it was a true feeling. Imagine like there was some energy flowing through me. You know, I felt like literally there was kind of electricity passing by me. It was, I don't know, it was imagination or really it happened. There was not even like 50% of the thoughts today I had like I did yesterday. It was such a, within one day, it was a great improvement actually. So I'm glad that, you know, I listened to all of you guys and improved. Thank you so much, Shauji. It was improvement I could see in one day.
Wonderful,
madam.
Sheetal, is there any way that you just explain about soul plan? Because when she mentioned about the kids that are working, that is the plan that they have chosen, and they have come onto the planet, Earth planet, and they are going through their whatever plan that they have. But we are thinking that it is going to be because of that and this and all, but that is not the case. Can you explain that one to everyone so that way actually in your words, because I know.
Yeah. So let me tell you a small story here. A person, a rich person goes to a village, like a mountain place. So there they have a small set of people, maybe 10 herds, and they are taking care of their needs, and they are like, you know, doing agriculture and whatever they need. And they are like, you know, taking footsteps, going to the town and coming, going to the town to do the grocery shopping at whatnot, right? And they're coming back. And this rich fellow noticed, okay, you know, he felt so sad at his heart that, you know, I should do something for, because they don't even have chappal, they don't have shoes, anything. And they are walking all the way from mountain to village to get the groceries and all. I have to do something. He was feeling so sad. So all that, like, you know, stones and all, they were, it is very rough drive. So he wanted to see what he can do. So he did little experiments, like, you know, he want to build a house. No, maybe the house, they are happy. Our grocery store, should I open the grocery store? No, that did not work. So many thoughts he gave. So then one day he did is he removed his shoes and he started walking from one hut to another hut. So when he was walking, his feet was hurting so much because all the stones, all the, like, you know, thorns and whatnot, right? It was like, it was so painful for him to walk. Then he decided, okay, you know, I wanted to do something, right? Let me buy chappal for all these people. So that, you know, they can walk with comfort and they can do their work, right? So he went to the city and he got slippers for everyone, and then he gifted everyone, and everyone wore that slippers and started walking. One day, 2 days, they felt so good, and third day they felt so annoying wearing a chappal. So they removed the chappal and they started continuing their journey. So what I mean to say is, it is all how you see the perspective, perception. They're happy walking on their feet the way they are doing. So the moment this chappal came, though it is a luxury, but they're not enjoying because they are so comfortable with that and they're continuing the life. So from their point of view, they are not sad at all. They felt sad about this fellow that, you know, he cannot walk without shoes. They were feeling that, you know, he cannot touch Mother Earth. He is very sensitive. He's like very emotional, whatnot, right? And they're very spiritually very strong. And see, that is what I want to say, that it is all our perception. We feel sad because now we are living in luxury. We are living in very nice place. And whenever we see people, we feel sad. But if you ask them, they feel sad for ourselves. They feel sad. Oh, they are living in mansions. They are not connected with nature. They are not enjoying not enjoying with animals, sleeping under the stars. They feel sad for ourselves. So it is all perception and it is lifestyle, a life design, as Ashok sir said, right? It is part of life, what we chose. Who knows? I might be a very poor kid in the past. I am done with that experience. Now I took this life. Who knows? I was a queen in my past life and I am done with that experience of having all the luxuries. Now I took this life. So every life is a design. Every life matters. Every life's experience is so beautiful. Only what we have to do is we have to develop the eye where we just witness without analyzing. Then we will be very happy. So hope this story helped Ashok Garu. It is all seeing perception, perspective, and also the one's own style.
Thank you so much. That makes so much sense. Even in the documentary I just mentioned, the kids were laughing, but I was crying.
See, that's what it happens. Yes. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for asking that question so that I wanted to, because of you, I was able to share this story as well. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Sheetal. Beautiful story. It has been connected rightly. Yep. Thank you. Harisha, ma'am, can you unmute yourself?
Yeah. Hi, Sheetal. Yeah, unmuted.
Yeah.
Again, it got muted. Thank you for the session, Ashokji and Sheetalji. So I just have one question during the session. During meditation, you mentioned like we can focus on the place between the eyebrows and you can meditate. Can you please elaborate more about that? Like, how do you do that also while focusing on the breath? I always have trouble doing both of them together.
Okay, so both are not separate, madam. So what I'm saying is, some people, they can find the breath here, right? Like this area. Some people mm-hmm. can feel the breath here. It is going inside, it is touching there, and then it is going inside, right? That's what I'm, I mean to say. It is just observing, like, you know, select a place so that, you know, we can, like, we can stick with that place and we can progress further. That's all I mean. So we are not focusing on third eye. We are not focusing on anywhere. It is a breath, but only thing is we are choosing our own place to observe. Like, okay. Like some people, they can feel the warmness here. Or some people, they can find their breath here. So it is all dependent. Yeah.
Yeah, because I in different sessions, I heard two different practices. One of them, they say like, try to bring your breath up to your navel part and then, you know, like try to focus that it is going up to that point. And in some other practices, I've heard a similar thing where try to focus your breath towards your third eye portion. I wouldn't say third eye, but maybe like between your eyebrows. So I want to know like what is a right way to do. And both are contradictory, going in different directions. So just trying to understand. Yeah.
All the practices are correct. Harisha, madam, all the practices are correct. There is no versus, there is no wrong. It is all up to you how faster you can progress. So for me, observing my stomach is, I feel little weird. Like, you know, I feel more thoughts when I observe my stomach, maybe. Okay. So I feel more comfortable because breath is right there. So it is easy for me to catch at the gate point instead of like, you know, going inside the room and finding my breath here or there, right? So I just catch my breath at my gate point. So that's why observing our breath is very simple technique.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Is anyone else wants to ask any questions or anything else today? Excellent. I don't see any other hand raises. It's already 10 p.m. here in ESP and 7:30 a.m.
So, Ashok sir, can I share a little bit for 2 minutes?
Yeah, sure, ma'am.
You know, just connecting to Shailaja madam's this thought, you know, most of us feel sorry when we see that kids or some people suffering, isn't it? It is not, maybe we feel sympathy, you know. And the other day, sir was explaining there is a lot of difference between sympathy and empathy. So please don't get confused. That's what Chandra sir was telling in one of the session. So just one example or one experience, let me share, sir. For my grandson's first birthday, what we thought was instead of calling the friends or relatives or anything, let us go to any this, what we say, to kids hostel or something, and let us distribute some sweets or some books or something for them. Okay, so we just choose one hostel, I mean where what we say to help them, like, you know, we contacted because I knew that lady who was maintaining that, because I got in touch with her in Art of Living and all. I said, I want to distribute some sweets and all for them and some compass boxes with pencils and erasers, all those things. So like that we did, you know, one thought came in my mind as well as my son's mind, you know, when they were sitting in a line and we were distributing that and all. How many of them feel happy about it? Can't say. Some kids who are very, you know, young, they must have felt some excitement and all. The kids who were in 8th or 9th, and they have their some self-respect, like, you know, how they must have felt. Like that, even in my mind also, the thoughts had come. Even my son was thinking the same thing. But we didn't discuss with each other. Second also, we did the same thing. Then I discussed with my son. I felt something is missing here, means some mistake we are doing, Pranav. How many of them must be enjoying the way we are giving them? We are feeling satisfied that we are distributing something. Then third year, we discussed with her and we said, collectively, we want to give something to this hostel. You tell us what you want. Then she said, we feel better if you can supply us some uniforms for us, ma'am. Because people will be benefited also. They need not sit in a line to get something from us and all. No? So after some days, my son had shared one this in a WhatsApp, you know, that one person was exactly, he was feeling the same thing and he was sharing. You know, we feel very great thinking that we can help people. But what happened is, how many of them are enjoying that, you have to think. How many of them are feeling bad when they are? So why don't you give them in a other way? Means without their knowledge, you help them from a backyard or whatever for the these people and all. Then we started thinking in a different way and we are following that. And I just wanted to share because so many of us do the same mistake. And after 2 years, we realized. And I just wanted to share that, Ashok sir and Sheetal.
Problem. Thank you, ma'am.
Great, great, Nirmala madam. So just want to finish with one sentence. As Sufi master says, when you are helping people, don't even let your left hand knows that you know your right hand helped.
Yes.
So if we remember, if we remember that, we never go and we never do direct help. We do it, but nobody knows that, you know, the help has been reached. Right. Your intention is help. Or your intention is to get that satisfaction. So yes. Two things are there. When you want to get satisfaction, self-satisfaction, you do self things. When you do that oneness feeling, then you do it like, you know, in your example, you must have given the money to the organization where they can buy compass boxes and give it to them.
Yeah.
So yeah, wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much, Nirmala.
Thank you for the story. Really, it is... means we have come to an other angle, you know. we shouldn't feel the sympathy, but we should feel, we should think in another angle also, how they must be feeling. Thank you. Right. Thank you, Sheetal, for the wonderful session. Thank you, sir. Ashok, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. So thank you, Sheetal, for a wonderful session again. And we will wait for the next session. It is going to happen for the next interview coming Tuesday. And thank you very much with your time and wisdom. Thank you. Thank you. And let me close with a beautiful song. And I hope everybody enjoyed the session.
Thank you, sir.